extreme close-up of glowing, honey-colored stones. Their shapes abstract as the camera examines air bubbles and crystalline patterns. Moving up and over this amber abstraction, the camera finds unusual shapes and imperfections caught in the glassy stone. Flecks of dirt, hairs, cracks, still moving, starbursts of light ricochet off the different surfaces of the stones. Camera turns along a creamy stretch of amber. It turns in deeper, abstracting the picture further only to find a tiny blur that suddenly racks into focus. A bug, a mosquito lodged within the amber tomb. It is folded on its back. Slow motion as the tip of a fine pointed drill bores into the amber toward the trapped bug. Orange flecks fly. The mosquito trembles.
Hold on a second. The drill continues. Just reading the setup for the movie Jurassic Park. Are you reading the script from Jurassic Park right now?
Yes. Stopping just before it touches the tiny body. Just a couple more. A shiny pair of thin needle nose pliers reach in the bore hole. Give me just one more second. The mosquito remains. These are dropped on a brightly lit glass slide. I promise I'm 80% done. The conveyor belt starts and the slide moves along, arriving under a long-lensed microscope. In microscopic perspective, a thin needle pierces the bug and delicately removes a fragment of tissue. 90% done. Pincers snare the fragment, dropping it into a narrow tube. The tube spins faster and faster until it is a blur on the screen. The screen floods with an infrared light. Gray oval shapes rock in a neutral mist. Wash out to hot sun overhead in a big sky.
Clever girl.
Today on the board, boys.
Dinosaur Island.
Dinosaur Island.
And if you're still listening, I apologize for that.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of the Board Boys Podcast, Season 7, Episode 3. We played Dinosaur Island tonight. This is your host, Life Finds a Way, Josh.
And this is Board Boy Rob.
And this is your boy, Newman, getting chomped off the can, Cam.
Newman wasn't chomped
off
the can.
Oh, he didn't get chomped off the can?
No.
Who got chomped off the can?
The lawyer guy.
God.
And this is your boy, Newman, getting chomped off screen?
He gets spit in the face.
Oh, the spit in the face.
The Dilophosaurus.
And this is your boy, Newman, wearing a white suit and slamming his amber cane down, trying to save his grandkids, Cam.
That's another character.
No, I know.
I think Cam is more like Dodds. We've got Dodds here.
Who's Dodds?
Nobody cares.
Nobody cares. We played Dinosaur Island tonight. We're going to talk about that here in a little bit. Before we get there, let's take it around the table for some games we've been playing lately. I'm going to have Rob start it off because I'm guessing Rob and Cam played the most games this week.
You're going to guess probably correct. I played like 37 games of Zombie Kids Evolution, which I've talked about on a previous podcast. I'm just going to say we finished it up. I think Bo and I might do a YouTube review of it. And he's probably going to poo-poo it because he was sorely disappointed with the final reveal envelope of the whole game. He loved it the whole time. He really was jazzed that something was going to be in this last envelope. It wasn't what he thought. And then he was sad. But overall, real fun, simple game that gets tougher as you go. And then you can kind of modify it as you go because there's extra rules that come in. I don't want to spoil it too much. That changes the difficulty a little bit.
Do you think you should warn parents that when the kid opens the final envelope, it just says that Santa Claus is not real?
That was not the surprise. And I actually thought the surprise was pretty cool, but he really wanted it to be something else, which it was not. So I will leave it at that.
Campbell, what about you?
Let's talk about a couple games of Thern and Taxis that I played. Bringing back, I think, the third game I ever added to my collection, the 2006 Spiel des Jahres, or however you say it, co-written by Andreas Seyferth of Puerto Rico fame, and then another designer whose name escapes me. I'm sorry. It's a kind of Ticket to Ride-y sort of route building game. From what, like 5 years before Ticket? When did Ticket to Ride come out?
2005.
Oh, from a year after Ticket to Ride, I guess, maybe the same year.
I could be wrong on that.
I thought Ticket to Ride was a little later, like 2009, but I'm super stupid. So, but Thurn and Taxis is a game where you're building like little post offices and upgrading your postal service all over like medieval Germany and Poland and the Czech Republic area. And what you do on each turn is kind of similar to Ticket to Ride in that you draw a couple cards with, like, instead of, like, colors, you draw cards with cities. And then on every turn, you have to play cards either at the front of your line of cards or at the back to make sure you have a route that, like, connects from one end to the other. And then when you close down routes, you get to place houses in these cities. And very simple. You can teach it in just a few minutes. And there's basically, you just do one thing every turn, but you get one of four special abilities. And really neat game, really simple, pretty fun, very old school. And
I will keep that in mind the next time I want to play a game about the German postal system.
Hey man, Thurn and Taxis, they're still royalty in Germany, baby, in Der Vaterland.
Germany.
I think France, too.
Cam, I was 1 year off. Ticket to Ride was 2004.
Say what?
Yeah, man. How about you, Josh?
I didn't play any. Well, that's not true. I played a couple games via apps since the last episode. Mostly the Sagrada app with my wife. She beat me every game that we played, so that was fun. But why don't you come back to me here in a little bit, and I'm going to make just the best app recommendation I've made in the history of the podcast.
Sounds great.
Don't sound so excited, Rob.
No.
Hey, Rob, what game did you play?
We also got to play a game of Smartphone Inc. I've got to play that twice now, I think. I played it once at three players and once at four players. Smartphone Inc. was just brought over by Arcane Wonders in the United States. And it came out last Essen. It is a economic type game where you're trying to sell cell phones. I like the theme is pretty thin on this one. But it's pretty neat. You're building up like your stores to go out in the different areas of the world to sell your phones. And how you do that is you start the game, the game's played over five rounds. And the first part of every round is you have these two little tablet boards with these different icons on them, and you have to overlay them in a certain way. And then depending on how you overlay them, you're going to get to take certain actions at a certain power for the rest of the game. Or for the rest of that round. And some of it will let you create goods that you can sell. Some of it will give you progress towards technology you can create. Some of them will help you grow your network so you can move out and branch out into more cities. And then ultimately, at the end of the round, you're going to be selling your cell phones in the different cities based on your price. And you always have to sell from the left to the right. And there's two different kinds of buyers. There's buyers that will buy solely based on price. So like, let's say you're selling phones for $5 this round, and there's a guy in a city that you can sell to that will only buy for $4. You can't sell to him, so you have to go to the next guy that might buy for $7, up to $7, and then you sell to him for $5. And then there's the purple buyers who will buy at any price as long as you own that technology. So it's very important to buy the technology so people want to buy your cell phone. So like my cell phone's got NFC in it, or better battery life, or I guess gaming is like one of the symbols. It's really neat. It's a little bit of cutthroat, I think, once you start like getting closer together. In the three player game, we played on the bigger board, and I think it would have been more fun if we played on the two and three player board, because it would have been a little tighter. Like we weren't really fighting together that much, but so far I'm having a lot of fun with this one. It looks a lot more difficult than it really is, and it's kind of similar to Dinosaur Island, as you kind of break down the turn structure into a bunch of different smaller steps. So like you're doing a bunch of different things. There's a lot of things to think about, but every step is small and kind of easy to take into bite-sized chunks.
hey, that game sounds cool. It also sounds like it's got a huge board. Cam, what have you been playing lately?
Got to play Smartphone Inc. with Robin. It's sweet. Also, Rob and I got to play Pan Am together that same day. And
Prospero Hall?
It's by Funko Games. And yeah, the designer is Prospero Hall.
Tight. They're crushing it.
Love them.
They just can't not... They can't put out a bad game. Or can they?
Well, I heard Jungle Cruise isn't good.
Yeah.
So Pan Am is a game about the golden age of flying around the globe. The game sort of follows basically the beginning of Pan Am's, like, as a company. Pan Am as a company, like mail planes and stuff, right? The founder, and all the way up to his retirement in 1933?
Something like that.
But it's a very cool game. Kind of, the way you play sort of reminds me of a competitive version of like Pandemic, sort of like kind of like color card matching and collection to go to different cities. But what you're doing is you're building routes from city to city that your planes can fly through, and you're trying to set them up in such a way that like the company Pan Am expands and buys them from you so that you can start taking more routes. And there's a very neat trade-off like between trying to like set up income and then like get paid right away, because a big portion of the game is like if you make a route, you get a base income for that every turn. But if Pan Am buys that route, your income actually goes down, but you get like a windfall. And as the game goes on, it's better and better to have your routes get bought, because what they'll pay you is more than you would have made. Mix that up with kind of a neat sort of Waterdavian, if you will, worker placement system, where you can get these like sort of action cards, and if you do, you get to be the first person to place your workers on the next turn. But also a worker placement bidding track for a lot of the things, where if you place a worker where somebody already has a worker, you're saying you're willing to pay more, and then they have to move that worker and can keep boosting it up. So all of those things come together in a really neat way. And I don't own Pan Am, but I want to. And I guess next time I'm at a Target that has it, I'll pick it up.
Yeah, I would say we thought that getting your roots bought was a pretty powerful thing. I got to play a 4-player game of it. And the cool thing I think about this game is the four of us did kind of different things, and we were all four of us were within 2 points of each other at the end of the game.
Oh, and that's the neat thing. It also has kind of one of those scoring systems where a couple points can really mean a lot, because the way you score points is by buying stock within Pan Am with the money that you get. And sometimes stock is really expensive, sometimes it's really cheap, and so you kind of have to like see how far you're willing to go, sort of. If you're the one who has all the money at the end of a round, you might spend a ton of it so that other people feel like they have to also, or you might keep your money and try to really expand on the next turn too. So
yeah, the cool thing we realized in our 4-player game was, so when Cam and I played, we played 2 players, and he went hard into just like getting Pan Am to buy his routes right away.
Yep.
Also, this is a game where I say the word route and route interchangeably like the whole game. Like I couldn't stick to a certain way of saying it. I think they're both acceptable. How do you guys say it?
I mean, I usually say root, but if people say route, I understand.
I say route.
Okay. And I was going for more like a long-term income thing, and right off the bat I'm like, oh man, this is not as good as what Cam is doing. But I ended up being pretty close.
Yeah.
But in the 4-player game, we realized, because there's events. Did you mention the events that happen like throughout the game?
There's
an event deck, and there's multiple ones for every round. But the last round, we looked through them, and they're pretty interesting, because a lot of them are like, if you've been building your income all game, it's like then you can sell all your routes to Pan Am at the end of the game, for instance.
Do you always do that? Or just...
No, but like that's on a couple of them, or like right. You gain money based on it. So a lot of the end cards, I think, help balance out the fact that you might be the person that was doing the... If you think that doing the income strategy is not as good as the windfall sell your route strategy, the end kind of almost balances that out.
Mm-hmm.
Because that final round card, I think, tips in the favor of the people that have a lot of planes on the board.
Right.
If that makes sense. So I feel like it's pretty balanced. I want to keep playing it. I taught it to a couple of they were non-gamerish. I would say it's kind of a gateway plus type game, as far as you can really teach this game to about anybody. I think it's a great addition to Target.
Oh, that's Target.
Yes.
My dad used to make that joke.
I am a dad.
It is pronounced Target. You can go back and forth on route and route, though, if you want. Hey, Josh.
What's up, Cam?
You had mentioned that you had the best app recommendation of all time.
I do.
And I really doubt that it's going to be that, but give it a shot.
I would like to recommend a game for you all this evening. I don't know if it's available on Android, so I will preface that.
Well, then it's not the best.
But it's called Dream Quest. Dream Quest is a roguelike dungeon crawler deck builder game that was developed by Peter Whalen back in, oh golly, early 2010s, between 2010 2015, somewhere in there. The game presentation is awful. It's you're buying cards and all the cards are drawn with like stick figures. He designed and programmed and did everything with the game himself. But where a lot of people will know Peter Whalen is he was on Team 5 at Blizzard, which means he was one of the team of 15 that was responsible for launching and maintaining Hearthstone. So, and he was brought on to Hearthstone because most people at Blizzard were familiar with Dream Quest, and the card play is incredible. It's so smooth. The ability to call your deck, to add new abilities. There's four classes. You can play as a priest, a warrior, a mage, and I'm going to blank on the last, a rogue, I think, or a barbarian. But the game itself is so fun. You're essentially trying to clear three levels, and if you clear all three levels, you win the game, and then you just play another game. I've played it probably 100 times, and I've only ever gotten to the third level like once or twice, because it's the kind of game where as you progress and as you play, you unlock more cards and, you know, different abilities to be able to do things. But I really can't say enough good things about it. Like I said, the price point is nice. I think it's like $5 or less.
$2.99.
It is seriously the best mobile game I have ever played in my entire life, especially for solo gaming. If you're looking for like a deck builder experience, I had asked on our Twitter, and a couple of people respond back to me, but I've seen a lot of love lately for a game called Slay the Spire, and I have not played Slay the Spire yet, but from what I saw, it looked very similar to Dream Quest. Not saying it's a copy by any means, but I said, you know, is Dream Quest similar to Slay the Spire at a fraction of the cost for people that are interested in a game like that? And a few folks responded and said, yes. Again, graphically, it's nothing to write home about. You're a little stick figure guy moving through, you know, a 20 by 20 grid that starts off, you know, dark, and you have to explore it as you go through, and you find these monsters that you fight. But mechanically speaking, and just like crafting a deck, it's in a class above for the $3 price point. It's seriously the best solo game I've ever played on my cell phone.
So when you meet a monster, do you like stop and fight it with your deck of cards?
You get to decide. There are so you don't engage a monster until you actually move onto its space, but there are certain monsters that as soon as they're revealed, they like pounce on you, and then you have to fight them. So you can try and uncover as much of the map as possible to figure out how you want to attack people, because you don't get health back unless you level up or if you find like a healing oasis. So you may lose all of your health right before you're supposed to go into a boss fight, which isn't great. Or what you can do is every time you clear a level, you get a new perk when you start the next level. And one of those is that you can remove all borders. So essentially, you can run through the whole map just to see where everything's at, but then you still have to go and you have to fight everything. So you can kind of plan it out and say, well, if I beat this guy and I beat this guy, that'll get enough experience that I can level up and then I can do this thing. But yeah, highly recommend if you're looking for a good solo game, check out Dream Quest. It's in the App Store for $3. Like I said, I don't know if it's on Android. Maybe it is, maybe it's not, but the game is good enough that it got this guy a very impressive, very high role at Blizzard for this app that he put together, which I think speaks to the quality of the game.
This game has me at the description where it talks about Magic the Gathering and Chandelar. I used to play the crap out of that Chandelar game for PC, which was essentially Magic the Gathering, only you like walked around and then you fought the monsters.
It's good. Once we get done playing, I'll show it to you before you, I mean, I highly encourage you spend the $3 to get it, but I will also show it to you beforehand. So yeah, check that out. Let's talk about Dinosaur Island, and then we will pick it apart. So before we get into it, Dinosaur Island came out in 2017. It has a score of 7.8 out of 10. Where does a score of 7.8 out of 10 put it on the top 100 or around the top 100? That's a clue. Rob?
Like 130.
Campbell?
I'm going to say 131.
It is 123. If you're looking at only theme, it's 32. Strategy is 92. The game is 1-4 players, best 3-4, 90 to 120 minutes, ages 8+, and it's got a weight of 3 out of 5. I will say this was the first title from Pandasaurus Games that really grabbed me. I know they had a couple games between like 2005 to like 2015. I know in 2017, they had a big hit with Wasteland Express Delivery or Wasteland Delivery Service. I haven't played that one, but I know that game got a lot of recognition. And then they dropped Dinosaur Island, and it blew up on Kickstarter. I missed it the first go around. I played it. I loved it. They did a second pressing of it with the Dulosaur Island and the Totally Liquid expansion, which is when I picked it up. But I feel like since then, they've been consistently pumping out some great games. They put out The Mind, which is one of my favorite just like fun party games to play. They put out Silver and Gold, which is my favorite it's not a roll and write. It's a flip and write. Yeah. It's my favorite flip and write.
I saw that in Target today.
Yeah. So, I mean, their big box games are great. Their small box games are great. But Dinosaur Island, for me, was the first one that put the studio or the publisher on my radar. Campbell, Rob, I don't care who. Why don't you guys talk a little bit about Pandasaurus Games and how you play?
Pandasaurus Games, huh?
Dinosaur Island. You know what I meant.
So in Dinosaur Island, you are creating your own dinosaur park. And you're trying to get the most victory points, which I guess is like, I don't know, they just call them VPs, but you want to be the most prestigious park or the best park or the sweetest park, get the most people to come to your park.
I mean, I think all the above. I think that it's like you get points for everybody who had like a good experience there.
Oh, yeah, like that they don't get eaten by a dinosaur.
You
know, like,
I think it's just recommendation, so you can continue making money so that you can make more crazy abomination of God dinosaurs.
Yeah. So the game is played over a few different phases, and you basically keep doing those phases over and over again until you trigger the end game. And the end of the game is triggered when, at the beginning of the game, you're going to set out a certain amount of end game goal cards, and as you go along, you are going to acquire those end game goal cards, and once there's one left at the end of one of the rounds, the game is over. The first phase, you're using your little lab scientist to go out and acquire DNA, acquire dinosaur recipes, up your cold storage so you can hold more DNA, or you can pass your worker and you can, or pass your scientist and use him as a worker later in phase three. Phase two is like a market type phase. Everyone gets to buy two things from the board, which is either going to be DNA or it's going to be like an upgrade for one of your worker spots for phase three. What are those called? Like construction sites? Or,
yeah, like workbench upgrades or something like that.
Yeah, you can buy specialists. You can have up to 3 specialists on your board at a time. And you can also buy attractions, which are like food vendors or clothing vendors or like amusement park rides. You can buy those in phase two. Then phase three is kind of a simultaneous phase where you use workers that you've got on your own personal board. Here you're like upping your security value or upgrading the paddocks for your dinosaurs so you can hold more dinosaurs. You can modify your DNA. You can create dinosaurs. I might have already said that.
Life finds a way.
Life does find a way. You can activate other abilities that you've got, that you've bought, like in phase two, that you put on your board as well. Then in phase four, people are going to show up at your park. Whenever you put a dinosaur on your board, it's going to up like an excitement level. It's going to up a threat level. That you keep track of on like a main board. You get to draw as many guys out of this bag as your excitement level. The yellow guys are patrons. They're going to go to your park and pay you. There's pink guys or purple guys, depending on the printing of the game you've got, that are hooligans. They're like sneaking in your park. They're not paying you at all. You get a dollar for every person that's not a hooligan. Then you get to place them on spots in your park. Anybody that can't place has to wait outside. Then you're going to check to see if you, the threat level, if your security level is meets your threat level. If not, you might get some guys eaten, and that makes you lose some points. Then you're going to gain points for guys in your park on spaces, or maybe money, depending on where you've put them. And then everything goes back in the bag. You reset the board, and you go through, and you do it again. You continue it like this until you've got only one endgame goal left. And then you count up some points. There's some endgame stuff. You get points for dinosaurs and a few other things. And then the most prestigious, highly rated dinosaur park wins.
Yeah, I think that pretty much summarizes it. Let's take a quick break, and we'll come back, and we'll pick it apart. Let's dive right in and talk about Dinosaur Island. I'm going to kick us off with initial reactions. I really like this game. I would call it Jurassic Park the board game if Jurassic Park didn't already have licensed board games, but I feel like this is the experience that I would want in a Jurassic Park the board game.
I feel like we all did a lot better than Jurassic Park did.
I mean, I lost like 40 points because I had people getting eaten every round. But
I would say Josh's first part of his game was kind of like the movie.
Right.
But the end of the game was like in the Jurassic World, where they come back and they've kind of got it figured out. So not as many people die, but then some people still die at the end.
I mean, it doesn't go good in any Jurassic Park movie, right?
I mean, define good.
I lost zero guys.
Yeah, with your your petting zoo.
Most of the guys I lost settled out of court and ended up paying me, so.
But yeah, so that's my immediate reaction. Rob, what'd you think?
Dinosaur Island was a game I originally backed on Kickstarter during the first thing, and I played it a few times, and it sat on my shelf. And then Josh was like, hey, let's play it for the podcast. And I had thought about putting it like on my cell pile a few times, and I even backed the expansion, the Totally Liquid one, but I realized that maybe I was thinking about putting it on the sell pile because I have had the expansion for 2 years and I have not touched it since then. So I was excited to get it back out, and we played it a couple days in a row now, and I'm on the fence. So we'll talk about it a little bit more in pros and cons.
I'm going to be real honest. I don't know why I like this game so much, because I feel like I have almost as much to grouse about as I do to praise.
Well, let's dive right in on those praises. Cam, why don't you start? What do you got?
Okay, so I'm going to start it off really like easy, but the theme from this game is like crazy, crazy fun. But they managed to make it into a like noodly little Euro game so that I would like it. And that's just the easy thing right there. But what's super cool about this game is they're able to throw in so many like little modules that make me enjoy playing it. Like each chunk of the game, which by the way is super manageable because they manage the game into like four phases, and all of which are like really easy to teach on their own. But not just the base game, but also if you add all the expansion modules, just continually have like fun little things to do. So there's a worker placement spot at the beginning of the game where you're like, you can upgrade some things. You can decide to like save guys for later, a la viticulture. You can like get your DNA. You get to do these little multiplier things. You have a strong worker, a medium worker, and a light worker, all of which can do neat stuff for you. Then you move into like this going and getting all the different fun things to upgrade your parks, and you take turns buying some things, and then you get to go do your own little like all at the same time little worker dude placement thing where you're, you know, pimp out your park, And then you get to like have the fun, you know, people coming to the park and getting chomped sort of thing. It's just all really fun. And every single thing you do for your park seems really meaningful. Like every little attraction you add really goes a long way, even if it can only hold one guy. Every specialist you get alters the game. Not to mention that every time you play, you have like moving goalposts of different objectives and different plot twists coming out that like extremely alter the way the game is going to get played that day. So if you want to distill that down into two sentences, super easy to digest, even though there's a lot going on, and just everything feels really good.
Yeah, I think you just touched on most of my pros in some way or another. So
oh, sorry.
I'm going to try to not kind of repeat what you said, but I do agree with you that they take a fairly complex game, and due to the way they structure it, they bring it down into manageable bite-sized chunks to where really, as long as you help people along kind of every phase of the first round, you can kind of, you almost kind of start playing.
Oh, totally.
Just so like, you're like, well, you're going to want to get some DNA and you're going to want to get a dinosaur, you know, make sure people kind of aim for certain things, but they don't need to know how that stuff happens till like later to maybe you can walk them through it and touch that stuff. So,
oh yeah,
I think the game's nice, a nice teach. I've taught a lot of different people this game, using that method. One of my big pros, I think, is the game length. I like the fact that it gives you a short, a medium, and a long objective card. So if you want to play a shorter game, you can do that. Although I highly recommend never playing the short game. Slight con there, because it can be super, super short. But I think the short game might be good for like younger kids. If you want to teach the game to like a younger child, maybe doesn't have as long of an attention span, because I think that game could really be done like in 2 or 3 rounds. I would say look up on BGG if you have the first edition. They did modify some things with the game length and number of players, and in the expansion they gave like a nice little chart of how many objectives you should be using per player. In the base game, it's 1 plus the number of players, and then it's not quite that for every player count, to kind of balance that a little bit. I also think the variability is super high in this game, just due to the plot twist, which I didn't talk about it in the explanation, but you get 2 of those every game and they basically just change a rule for how it goes, or like add something that can go a long ways. And I think the art style for this game is just bonkers. Like, I think you either like it or you don't, and I love it. They really went for like this weird 90s neon theme, and
yeah,
it really works for me.
Yeah, I love it too.
Yeah, I would agree. I think we normally don't play with modules, and we played with a few tonight that I really enjoyed. I think the executives and whatever the other thing were a lot of fun. The Mega Rex, like I know Campbell got goats that he could use to offset like the threat. I ended up going with one that helped me like wait a bit, but then get dinosaurs for cheap. And you went with the petting zoo, I think, which is ultimately what got you a ton of points, right?
Yeah, I went hard into the petting zoo, and it was fruitful.
The whole like visual of a dinosaur petting zoo is hilarious to me. But yeah, I think this game's great. I think the theme kind of sucks you in, and I think if you have the Kickstarter version or even just the basic version, the dinosaur meeples are really fun, just to help you get sucked into the theme of what you're doing.
Do those come with the base game?
The dinosaur meeples?
Yeah.
Yes.
I think so. I feel like the dino meeples are standard. I don't, they're not just going to be like, oh, pink cubes. Like, put a pink cube here, put a pink cube there.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. I have also seen that people put googly eyes on their dinosaurs, and it looks amazing. Just like little mini googly eyes on the dinosaur meeples. But yeah, I thought some of the variability in those cards was a lot of fun. I also like that there's definitely a, I went a strategy of like having just like a bunch of really cool big dinosaurs and having like a lot of the attraction. And while I felt really good about my final board, I probably rushed a bit too much to get there because there's like the balance of having too much threat versus what your security is. And I was, you know, having to have people get eaten every round. I like that it encourages you to grow, but not grow too quickly. Cause I went negative 11 points and you start at 10 points. So I went on a 21 point swing, just to get back to zero, and I ended up losing by like 30. But yeah, I like that. It's like, I mean, the game's just like, okay, Josh, like you can do this thing. Do you really need that dinosaur this round? Or are there like other things that you can go and do? And I was like, no, it's Jurassic Park. I got to get the dinosaur.
Yeah. I mean, you can just make a great story out of your park, right? Like, so this game just lends itself to creating a pretty cool narrative.
Yeah.
Like I was over here with my baby little petting zoo and like the kids were coming in and doing that. And like, you're over there with an inexperienced crew, like hatching giant monster dinosaurs that you can't control.
Yeah, it was great.
Mine was a real sleazy one. I was like, I had a bunch of money bag guys and like I was just making tons of money. But like every round I would like purposefully have a dinosaur eat one of the people in there because I had a card that allowed me to like take them to court. Like back for taking us to court.
Oh yeah.
And get like extra money. So it like actually behooved me to have a dude get chomped.
I think like I have the deluxe version, Cam. I know, back to your question about the dino meeples, I want to say like the regular game has the dino meeples, but like it's one print of them. Like it might be all stegosauruses or something.
Oh.
Whereas like mine has, I don't know, like a dozen different
types.
So
when you sell it to me, are you going to charge me extra because there's a dozen different types of dinosaurs?
I don't think you can afford it, Cam.
Ooh.
Oh. $50? The one other thing I will say is I do like the player order mechanism in this game. So, I mean, it's whoever's in last place becomes the first player. And in the Duxified version, you get this cool slap bracelet fast pass that lets you go. But the way that I was playing the game, I had the benefit, I mean, it didn't win me the game, but I had the benefit of being the first one to go every round just in an effort to try and catch up. And so I like that it had a little bit of a built-in, you know, get caught up and like a catch-up mechanism, essentially.
Hey, I want to comment on that really quick because this isn't the hugest deal of all time, but I do think that the game could use an edit with that. I think that it's good that the person in last gets to do their actions first. However, that's a really big benefit. And we played last night, and I found myself in a situation where I was patently not doing any better than anybody else, but I kept having to go last simply because we were just tied. And part of me thinks there should be some sort of adjustment you make to the turn order track if everybody's tied, whether that's just to boomerang it so that if people are tied multiple rounds like we were for the entire game last night when we played, that people get the opportunity to like swivel back and forth, or perhaps maybe you look at like who has less points in dinosaurs at that point or something like that. I don't really know what it would be, but it really sucked to continue going last when I was tied with everybody else just because I'd been going last before that.
Well, I was going to save that for my con, but since we're talking about it now, we're going to jump around a bit. I'm not sure that I think it's a super big con, but I do know, like, I've read a lot of forums and threads about this game, and I felt this a little bit sometimes, sometimes not. I've seen it go both ways. Like, the game last night, I tried playing the sleazy way that I don't think that I think kind of sucks, where I was purposely taking shops and stuff that I could take money. So I was tanking my points so I could always go first, but just stay right behind everybody. But I was also like building up a bunch of dinosaurs. So like I had a ton of points, but I wasn't generating enough points every turn to like change the turn order. So like a lot of people think that it's kind of got that power grid thing where you kind of want to stay just right behind and then like shoot forward and beat people at the end, kind of a thing.
Yeah.
So whether or not like that's a pro or con, but tonight I did the complete opposite of that. And I just rocketed into first place and held on to it and never let go. And I won that way too. So maybe it doesn't matter.
Right. But I think it's a lot more frustrating going last like every single turn, like all game long.
Well, I did that this game, I was frustrated, but I still won.
You know, it's not frustrustrating though, going first every single round, which was nice.
That is true.
There was one other thing I was going to say. I'm a sucker for, I know I normally don't talk about components, but as I do have the Kickstarter backing as well, the metal coins are great. They feel good. They look good. There's a lot of attention to detail there, which I appreciate, which is good because from what I've heard from Rob, there maybe is not the same level of attention to detail on a couple other things in the game, which we may talk about when we get to the cons.
Have you opened your copy yet?
Oh, no. I was going to crack it to bring it over.
Because your coins, I think, are thinner than mine.
Okay.
And I think that's better.
Okay.
To be honest.
I'll take a look when I get home.
I think they made them thinner.
Because I've heard this game has a really good solo mode as well. I have not played it.
I haven't read it, but I think it does too.
But I've heard it's really, really good. And, you know, maybe I'll start to be a solo gamer when I'm not playing Dream Quest or The Last of Us 2 or playing with Ice Pick. So we'll see. Any other pros that we want to throw out? I think the playtime's good. I mean, this game wasn't too long. I know we had the teach, but I didn't feel like it took too long to play. And we played the long game. I do like that. The games have, do you want to play a long game? Do you want to play a medium game? The times I played this before was a medium game, and I didn't feel like I got to do everything I wanted with those like blueprint cards. Yeah, I think this game's got a lot of good stuff.
Here's a prawn. Is I think that there are things I enjoyed about the long game more than the medium game, and I think there's things I enjoyed about the medium game more than the long game, and I really wish there you could kind of meet in the middle.
Well, you probably could. I mean, depending on the cards, you can do a couple things. One, and there's multiple variants for this game. One is they say if you want to pick out your own plot twist cards. Like if there's plot twists you guys like to use,
oh sure,
pick them. Two. If you want a slightly longer game, but you want to stay more on the medium length, maybe just use one more medium objective. Like, you can do that.
Oh, sure, yeah.
So I mean, maybe that's the easy fix, because I'm kind of with you there. Like, I like the fact that in the medium game, we kind of got... It could have maybe gone one more round, maybe, but I still like that length. You couldn't do everything. In tonight's long game, like, we were filling our boards up. There were certain phases of the game where, like... Well, I'm just saving these guys because I'm not going to do anything in phase one. And like, I have nothing to buy in phase two because I've already bought all my specialists. I don't need any more specialists. I don't need any more of these things. All we're doing then is buying the attractions. I didn't touch upgrades after like round two or round three because like I had them all already. I can see like where the long game to me tonight felt a little long maybe, but it really wasn't.
Right.
The length wasn't long. What I was doing felt like a little long. Like I actually like completed everything, but maybe some people like that in games. Some people like my wife, she wants to like do everything and like finish stuff. And like, I think she would enjoy that part, although she doesn't like long games, but she would feel more complete if she got to do that. Whereas like in games where you have to pick and choose and like have to needle your way through and decide what you want to do and what you're going to skip, not so much. So I think it kind of depends on the player you are as far as that goes. I feel like I fall somewhere between the medium and long game. And I think depending on looking through the long objective cards, there were some that were just like, I feel like that's going to take way longer than some of the other long ones. I think you could really set yourself up for some super long games, right, or maybe some not as long games, depending.
Don't you feel like, though, that this game really differs from, like, when I think of a game where you can't do everything, I think of games by the Italian designers we like, you know, like Newton or Voyages of Marco Polo, or I think of, like, a Lacerda game. But the difference between those games and this game, to me... And why I think it's less, like why it's more frustrating to like have the medium game is twofold. One is because you don't really know what round the game is going to end, although this has a pretty clear, we're probably going into the last round sort of deal. So that's not that big of a deal. But to me, this game just has so much less like combo-y stuff and kind of like efficiency stuff. To me, that's the sort of stuff that makes you feel really accomplished when you squeak out more than you thought you could in a game like Marco Polo, whereas you're really limited in this game to being able to do a very set amount of things.
It's pretty straightforward.
Right. And so to me, like, the medium game just seems like a little unsatisfying. It's just like I kind of built my park like halfway, and I don't think that, like, no matter really what was going on, unless we played with some crazy plot twists in a medium game, I'd ever get more than that. It's just about beating somebody else by some points, and then the long game I kind of feel like I got to do a little too much. And so that's the gripe.
Yeah,
but
so maybe,
it's not that big of a deal.
Maybe play a medium with another objective.
Exactly.
But I also think it depends on what kind of people you're playing with. Like, if you're playing with people that are see the objectives and, like, are shooting for them. Like, we shot for a couple objectives this round, like, that I think that we went for just because we wanted the objective.
Well, because you have to.
I mean, because somebody else is going to do it, right?
Because
if you don't do it, someone else is probably going to do it. But, like, I got two objectives this game, and both of them, I didn't need to get that round, but I knew other people were going to maybe either get it or stretch for it, so I also, like, basically wasted a lot of stuff just to make it happen.
You know what I might like in this to make the game, like, make a medium game last a little longer? Is, and this would be a huge house rule, so, like, I'm not suggesting it, but what might be an interesting concept is just allowing people to claim objectives in a later round and get like three quarters of the points, kind of Yokohama style, where, like, now you don't have to race to this objective, because as long as you get it before the end of the game, you at least get most of those points. Because so then, I don't know.
I kind of like racing for them, to be honest.
Yeah. I don't know. It's not that huge of a deal. I still like this game. Like I said, I like this game a lot more than you would think. I've already griped about it twice, and we haven't even hit my major gripe.
How about you, Josh?
What was the question?
I mean, I think we're kind of going into cons now.
Sure. Might as well. Campbell, what's your big one?
Do you think you know what the big one is?
No, Campbell, I don't.
Do you have no cons, Josh?
Well, if we have cons, we can talk about it. But Campbell said he's got a big one.
Oh. Well, you so asked that like you, no. The reason is you asked it. No, me like you knew what it was.
No, you just said you have a big con. So I just want to.
I do.
There, that.
There's one thing I really don't like about this game.
My guess is he already covered off on player order. And it wasn't that.
It doesn't have to do with the variable game length, right?
Nope.
Yeah, you can tell.
No, neither of those are that big of a deal for me.
You can tell when the end of the game is coming, which is something that Campbell doesn't like. Like, if the game just ends abruptly.
Right, but he said that wasn't it either.
No, which this game doesn't have. Let's see. There's no kazoos in this game, nope. So that might have something to do with it.
Mm. It is the problem I have is both thematic and a very cam gripe at the same time.
It's thematic.
You don't feel like you're building a dinosaur park?
Nope, not at all. I love that. I really think you. So here's my gripe.
Just tell us.
I think
I'm on the literal edge of my seat. Right
I
now.
Have a
the
real,
edge of my seat.
I have a real problem with certain aspects of the hooligans in this game. Not entirely, but a little bit. And here's what's up. So you are out on this, thematically first, you're out on this island, right? So people have to take a boat or a plane to get to you, right?
Or a bridge, you know. They never said where the island is geographically located.
And so at minimum, you're walking across a bridge.
Sure, yeah.
Get to this island. And all of a sudden, you draw a couple of these hooligans, and they're just in your park. They're not paying. They hop the fence. Right? Now, you can get security to, try to, bust those dudes out. I don't have that big of a problem with the fact that the hooligans aren't paying, although thematically, I think it's kind of weird that they, flew the plane there, paid for a ticket, and then, all of a sudden, they, push into the park before anybody else.
Maybe they are family members of the workers at the island.
Sure, maybe.
Yeah, I'm not following you on this one.
Anyway,
I know. He's pissed that the hooligans, because thematically, the hooligans would be the ones that are, causing trouble at the park. So when the dinosaurs eat
this
people,
is, yeah, this
they
is
should
my problem.
Eat the hooligans first
this,
because they were the ones that were probably, not paying attention.
This is my problem. The game, it doesn't, a coin doesn't matter a whole lot, but you could draw a bunch of hooligans and then you're already screwed. You're not getting anything for these guys. And then you just have to sit there and watch them like not do anything while like your regular guys get like you're getting double punished for having bad luck. And you could, I mean, like, Rob, we were like 7 points apart. If the game was like a few points tighter.
We were 12 points apart.
Oh, whatever.
I didn't add my 5 at the end.
Oh,
the
sure.
What did,
what did you get the 5 for?
For removing hooligans from the bag.
Oh, weird.
Yeah, so here's the thing. If you are really that butthurt about hooligans, like you said, there's multiple ways to mitigate hooligans. Take a special guide that helps you. Take a thing that lets you put them back in the bag. There's
so many cards.
There's tons of ways to mitigate the hooligans if you care about
that. Yeah, discard the hooligans.
Or roll the dice and don't do it.
I'm saying
hooligans sneak into your park. They're jerks. You don't like randomness. I get that. But the hooligans are so sneaky, the dinosaurs don't eat them.
I don't hate... No, the only thing I hate is that the dinosaurs can't eat them. I get
that... They can eat them after they eat everybody else.
But what I'm saying is... That's the
maybe
only,
the hooligans don't
the
taste good,
I,
Cam.
That's the only
they're
thing
purple.
I have a problem with. I understand that you're like taking a risk with the hooligans. I think that it's fair that they don't score and they don't give you points. But if the dinosaurs come chomping, you should be able to chow down on hooligans. That's all I'm saying.
That feels like a pretty weak con, personally.
I don't know. It pees me, man.
Over the game, aren't we all going to draw about the same number of hooligans?
Yeah, absolutely.
Probably.
Yeah, yeah. I would agree with that.
Also, I mean, it depends on who... So the turn order for that also matters because we're drawing out, like... So if whoever goes first draws a bunch of hooligans out, that's less for me to draw, but they might leave more in the bag. So, like, that changes the odds. I think that's kind of a neat thing.
The only problem I have is I just think you should be able to chow down on hooligans.
You can after you eat everybody else in the park.
No, but I'm saying you should be able to do it before.
Well, you should have built the dinosaur that eats hooligans.
Yeah.
Is there a dinosaur that eats hooligans?
Yeah, it's called the Hooliganosaurus.
Is there one of those? If I could build that dinosaur, I would.
Quick pro.
Why couldn't I tweak a DNA and make a dinosaur that likes hooligan flesh?
DNachos is the... greatest name for a nacho dinosaur themed restaurant ever.
Oh no, it's Clever Grill.
Oh, that was good too.
I like Rex-Mex.
That was good too.
To be fair, the humor in this game is also on point.
Yeah. One of the cons for me, just because, and it was just so annoying to deal with all game, especially like I said, I went heavy early in the game to having a high extreme level so I could pull more guys from the bag and try and get more points. And there's a mechanism in the game where, the first thing that you do when you're setting up a round is you roll these dice that you can assign your workers to get your, you know, to get your different genes for the things you're going to do. And whatever dice isn't taken, you take the highest valued one and you add that to the threat level. And there were multiple times in the game where like a bunch of threat level 3 things would come out and like nobody was really taking dice cause they didn't need them. So I was like catching up to get my security beefed up. And there were a couple instances where like I finally got there and then it was just like, cool, add 3 more for the round. And it's like, oh, that's so, it's so brutal. And it's random every round. So some rounds you may be good. You may only be off by 1, which isn't the end of the world. But then out of nowhere, you're like, suddenly you're off by 3 and you're just like, ah, I really don't want to have to lose 3 guys potentially.
But you're off by 3 and like you know that from phase 1 though, right? Like you have phase 2 and phase 3 to try to fix that.
Oh yeah, you definitely do. But I mean, the cards just sometimes aren't there. I got by that a couple times, and again, I only lost by like 30 points, Rob. So take everything that I'm saying as if it were the gospel, please.
So what I like, there's something that I like about this that you reminded me of. A pro for me is the player interaction in this game for like a worker placement type game is pretty good, I think.
Yeah.
There's the DNA dice that like you're fighting for. You're kind of fighting for the dinos. And then in phase 2, because like if you take DNA, you can discard stuff that people might want. I know I complained about that during the game because like stuff got discarded that I want, but like that's like a defensive move and like that's cool. I think the all of that is good. Like the phase 3, you're kind of doing your own thing, but like the phase 1 and phase 2,
there's quite a bit of player interaction there.
The only other thing that I would say, and this is a subjective con, but I would love to see whether it'd be like a specialist ability or something, but I would love to see a way to maybe cycle the dinosaur cards. There I know we replaced the water dinosaur like every round or whatever, but there were a couple dinosaurs that just weren't great. And there's only one space for like the herbivores, the small carnivores, and the large carnivores. So if nobody wants to go and like take that dinosaur, it just...
Well, here's the con. Another con for that is they're all the same. Besides the cost. The costs on them were different, but an herbivore, a small carnivore, and a large carnivore, every large carnivore has the same exact stats. They just have different costs. Mm-hmm. So like one of my cons for the game is... Without the expansion, I think the base game, and I think this is why I quit playing it, was I played it a few times, and it kind of got samey a little bit. Because like those dinosaurs are always the same. You saw a lot of the same stuff over and over again. I really think the expansion, while not necessary, really jacks it up and gives a lot more replayability. I know I gave replayability as like a pretty big pro because of some things, but like having those water dinosaurs that are like completely different stats for all of them, that's really cool.
I think
and then there's just more stuff, you know, you get more dice, you get more specialists, you get more upgrades, just more different things.
Well, the extra thing you have, the extra like executive worker, and then like if they had a module where like all of the dinosaurs were different, that would be so rad, because the marine dinosaurs make it so much more fun.
Yeah, I wish all of the dinosaurs, like I wish all the herbivores were like slightly different somehow. I wish they were all like that.
I wish there would be an opportunity for like small and large herbivores. Because there's the small carnivores and the large carnivores, and I feel like some of the coolest dinosaurs are like the big herbivores. You know, you've got your Dilophosaurus, you've got your Stegosaurus, your Triceratops. Like those are awesome herbivore dinosaurs, and you know, if you don't see them come up, it's kind of like womp womp.
Yeah, my only other con is the game and rulebook had quite a few like component misprints, and the main one, like, and there's actually a pretty large FAQ, and like especially if you have everything for this game, there's a little bit of confusion. There's the different sets, there's like the Dinosaur Island, and there's the Deluxe, and then there's the Dual Soul, or the Totally Liquid expansion, and then there's the Dinosaur Island Extreme Edition, which is the one you've got, Josh, which is the second one. And like the rule book had some inconsistencies with a few different things. Like it said, this Meeble color is this, like the hooligans are purple and the VIPs are pink, and they got those mixed up. And then, in the expansion, they mixed up some other stuff with the executives, like the little yellow meeples we've got, those, like the wording on a lot of the stuff is confusing. The rule book is okay. I have a hard time finding stuff in that rule book too, so I'd say I'm not a huge fan of the rule book. I do have a one sheet printout that, once you know the game, that printout is pretty amazing, and it reminds you of all the steps, and it's super easy to follow. But the production is great. The rule book and some of the mismatching components are not.
Yeah. Anything else, or do we want to throw it over to Chris real quick to see what he thinks on Dinosaur Island?
I could nitpick one other small little tiny thing.
Please do. I'm on the edge of my seat.
This is really small and I really don't care about it, but it would be cool, I think, if you maybe before the beginning of the game could get a dinosaur type that you wanted, because I think getting like locked out of having a dinosaur type that you want in the first and second couple rounds, it could be really frustrating, and it hasn't happened to me ever. But it wasn't like, weren't you like kind of sad, Rob, like there was a dinosaur you wanted early? And I don't know, maybe not, maybe it's totally fine. But maybe then that wouldn't make going first very good.
I sometimes
I give up.
I know a lot of folks that listen to the podcast can't see facial expressions, but every once in a while Campbell will say something and I always sit across from Rob and we'll both just kind of look at each other like, do we want to say something there? And there's just like this pause that goes on for like the perfect amount of time, and then Campbell will pick up on it and then he'll just be like, so anyway, here's what I was thinking about this thing. And I love it. It's not even like a knock. It's just the chemistry that we've kind of developed on the podcast.
Here's what's up is these guys are like just legitimate pricks and they discount everything I say. But here's what they don't know is that I'm right like 99% of the time and they're wrong like 99% of the time.
I will say, I feel like we've come full circle playing this game because the very first episode that we had you on the podcast, which I think was Alchemist when we came over, you had just gotten this in the mail and I went to bed. I left after we played Alchemist, but you and Campbell stayed up until like 3 a.m. that night.
We did.
Cracking open Dinosaur Island and learning it and playing it. And I was so glad I went home.
Yeah,
so.
We just stepped through it, man. Yeah. We took it down.
But well, let's throw it over to Chris and let's hear what he says about Meeple Overboard.
I bet Chris feels exactly the same way about this game as I do.
You're calling your shot like with Maracaibo?
Yeah, this is like I'm pointing at center field.
Yeah. Cool. Let's hear what he has to say.
Hey everyone, this is Chris from Meeple Overboard with another segment of the Meeple Overboard Boys podcast. Today, I'm here to talk about the greatest scientific achievement in recent history, the marriage of excellent themes with bland Eurogame mechanisms in Dinosaur Island. Dinosaur Island is a game that I'm actually of two minds about. I think that it's both quite a good game, but also quite a massive, bloated game. It's not one that I want to keep coming back to. It has fun elements to it. I like the dice drafting-ish kind of thing, the worker placement that's going on. But it has a few too many boards and a few too many phases for me for the weight of the game that it is. It is a medium weight game. It is enjoyable and it's fun, but there's just a lot going on, and I think that this could be perhaps a simplified game, almost like if they'd come out, say, I don't know, with like a two-player Dinosaur Island type variant on it. Though that one did have a little bit of a lacking of replayability for me. It just, the Dinosaur Island as it was just not deep enough for the amount of stuff and the amount of things to keep in track. It's a game that I would never want to teach, but I would play again. If you invited me to your home to play Dinosaur Island, I'd play it again because I think the greatest strength that it has are the plot twist cards, which will keep each game different from one another. But just not enough for me to say that it would be worth buying a huge chunk of plastic inside of a cardboard box, and not one that I want to keep revisiting. So ultimately, that's kind of my thoughts. There's a lot that's great to be said about it. A lovely theme. I constantly get the Jurassic Park theme stuck in my head during many games, but during this one especially. And so I would say that the greatest achievement of this is launching Pandasaurus as a company into the public zeitgeist. So for that, I'm grateful, but I will not own nor pursue Dinosaur Island. My name is Chris from Meeple Overboard. Thank you so much.
Hey, thanks as always, Chris, for that wonderful and short summary of
Dinosaur
Island.
That was weird how you talk about dinosaur eggs for so long, because it's really a small component of just a modular thing in the expansion. But
he also has an unhealthy obsession with Newman from Jurassic Park.
Does he really?
Well, we're talking about. Did you just?
Yeah,
not listen
sorry.
To that?
My bad. Yeah, I forgot. Final thoughts. Dinosaur Island, cool game. Do I regret not cracking it sooner? Yes. After playing it, am I in a rush to crack it? Probably not.
I'll buy your copy, Josh.
However, if I were a solo gamer, I'd probably crack it like tomorrow and try and set it up. Maybe I'll sell it to Campbell. Maybe I'll use it as trade bait on BGG. But I do like this game. The theme's great. The mechanisms are cool. It's good.
Do you know what I'm loving about this the most?
What?
That I think.
Hold on. Define this.
This game.
Oh, what?
I think out of the three of us, the one that's most jazzed about it is the one that doesn't own it.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think I was that jazzed about it until I started played the expansion, though.
So, like I said, I haven't played this game in a couple of years. I had the expansion. It wasn't enough. I think...
You got rid of Dinosaur Island, didn't you?
Yeah, so... Side tangent. I backed Dinosaur Island 2, played it a couple times. It was fine. I moved on and got rid of it. I got this expansion, and I don't know why, like, when a game gets into, like, two boxes for me, I'm like, that's a lot of stuff to, like, figure out and set up, whatnot. I picked up a couple inserts, and I think it's made it a whole world better of, like, for organization. And I'm getting better at setting it up and whatnot. I think that this game will be brought up more often, because when I say Jurassic Park in a box, everyone's ears perk up. Another couple we play games with pretty frequently was like, why haven't you showed us this game yet? So I'm going to keep it in the collection. I mean, I rated it an 8 on BGG, and I would probably stay there. It maybe dropped to 7.5. The expansion probably keeps it in an 8, though. I think the expansion is what I needed. I think when I got the expansion, I read the rule book for it, and for some reason, I felt a little overwhelmed just due to all the different modules. But now that I've played with them twice, they're all really easy to add in, and I think they're almost all essential for me from now on, except for maybe the, I guess we can go over the five. There's a fifth player, which I don't know that I'd ever want to play this game with five.
Right, Campbell, five. I don't think so.
There's the water animals or water dinosaurs. Water dinosaurs must play.
Yeah, except for some of them seem like a little harsh, but most of them were really pretty cool.
With the caveat that I think in this game is a new house rule that just so the cost can be different. I think we should, if a dinosaur didn't get bought, I think we just roll it to the bottom every time, no matter if what it is, because Josh mentioned that too. And then I really can't remember what the special boards we had that was like the Megarets, the baby dinosaurs. I could take or leave that, I guess, but the meeples, the special meeples, I really liked. I think the extra board might be a little too much to teach somebody on the first play, potentially, because the game already takes up a lot of space.
It does.
And then we didn't play with the PR. That's whatever for me. The PR, everybody gets two cards, and you pick one at the end of the game, and everyone scores everyone's card they picked. And then the last thing is the blueprints, and I thought the blueprints would be cool, but I'm very meh on the blueprints too. Basically, it just gives you points if you build the park the way your blueprint says. And like, maybe I'm meh on it because I've done sucky at it twice.
I like the blueprints.
But like, I feel like it shoehorns you in a little bit on what you're supposed to be doing, and I don't like it.
No, but here's the thing. Like you said, I'm the guy who doesn't own the game, but I'm more jazzed on it now. Playing it with the blueprints and the water dinosaurs made me enjoy it so much more than I ever had before. One, because I always wanted to get attractions, but I felt like they were undervalued. And that just helps them be worth a couple more points because they're so expensive already. And then the marine like dinosaurs, I think blueprints are awesome.
I didn't think about it like that.
Like it makes a part of the game that I thought was like not that great really good.
So final thought, I think I'm going to hold on to it definitely for a couple more years until at least Bo can play it. And then maybe we'll see where it goes from there.
Whatever. Sell it to me today.
Okay. Well, I'll sell it to you for $200.
You can't afford it
right now.
To be fair, if I were to sell it right now, I would want almost Kickstarter money out of it.
What was Kickstarter money for it?
$150.
Probably.
I'll give you $141.
Okay.
Are you sell it for $141, Josh?
Times 10. Oh, got him.
I don't want it that bad.
All right. This has been season...
Whoa,
seven.
No. Josh is trying to get out of something we
Josh,
definitely
I have,
are doing.
I have multiple things to still talk about.
Oh, that's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, I also didn't give my final thoughts, I don't think.
And did you give your final thought? You did.
Yeah, I did. I said this game's cool. Cam, what's your final thought on this one?
It's cool. Extra cool. I really like it. Despite having like a different things than I normally appreciate in a game, I really enjoy it.
I will say when we brought this out yesterday... Or when I decided, hey, let's play this yesterday, and Jason and Cam were over, Cam's like, well, what about these other like 12 games? Like, I don't think he was into it.
Now, right. Campbell.
And then I think playing it, he really turned around on it.
Campbell, I think it was the blueprints and the marine animals.
Would you say that this game's got Wombo?
No.
Does it got Wobble?
No.
Does it have a clever mechanism?
Yes.
Does it have combo?
Does it have social components.
A little bit.
Then this game only has half of what you look for in a
game. Well, no,
this
but I have four new pillars today if you want to hear about them.
Yeah, what are they?
What's your four pillars of Dinosaur
it's got
Island?
Herbivores, carnivores, large carnivores, water carnivores.
Warnivore carnivores. No, I mean, a game doesn't have to have... So I think... I'm always hard-pressed for the fourth one, but I really do think that, like, Combo Wombo, like, and that efficiency, you know, like, wobble, and then the mechanism thing are really those things I like. This game has the one, which is, I think, like, a unique, like, kind of the way the game is set up. And that's what I really like about it, despite the fact that it's not an efficiency puzzle and that it's not a game where you have to, like, figure out how to game the game. You just have to do what everybody else is doing slightly better than everybody else.
Sure.
And I think that's what shines about it. The game, like I said, wasn't that fun for me until I played with... I mean, it was fun, but I think, as I think about it, the different dinosaurs were awesome. And then, like, the things that were added in the Liquid expansion really made it fun. Because I would really want to play next time with a different worker and with a different little specialty pen, too.
So, last word on Dinosaur Island. Since everyone you know owns it, Cam, you need to go buy Dinogenics, which is the other Dinosaur Jurassic Park game. And then we can play that. Because I want to know how good that game is.
That game looks tight.
Oops, I guess it's not unique anymore. Oopsies.
It does look fun.
Rob, what do you have for us now?
All right. One, to follow up from last week when we talked about Caribbean-style games and zombie games and trading the Mediterranean games, I went to the BGG advanced search. And there was no way to search for trading in the Mediterranean. But I did search between zombies and... I forget the exact term, but it was like Caribbean theme. And there were two more pages of Caribbean than zombies total, which I was kind of impressed by because I really thought zombies would be more. But then I thought about it, and I think I probably have at least 10 games that have to do with that are based in the Caribbean. I didn't count them, but maybe I'll do that for next time.
Well, I told you I'd played way more zombie and Caribbean games than I had Mediterranean games. Yeah.
Also, I didn't find a good way to work this in, but my buddy David messaged me today after listening to last week's podcast, Board Boy number 6, and he told me it was the stone cold lock of the century of the week. And that's what Carl from Aqua Teen Hunger Force says.
Yeah, for the Super Bowl pick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's what I was trying to say was, you know, that was my stone cold lock of the century of the week.
Yep. 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 Okay. All right.
Are we doing a Board Boys bump?
I just want to bring that back. Now, I would like to bring us into the Board Boys bump.
Bump. Oh, no, hang on. Baby, turn around. I wanna see that sexy body go Board Boys bump.
Cool. Thanks for that new theme song, Campbell. Board Boys bump or dump is a new segment we started this season. We've talked a lot about we're legitimate media major influencers, and every game that we review seems to just move its way up in the rankings on the BGG list. We have not. We've had a dump and a game that, if you think about it, it's kind of a bump because we played it 2 years ago and it hasn't changed position. But
if a game stays the same,
but games that are above it,
that's a bump.
Yeah, games that were above it are now below it and it did not move.
Or at least a life vest.
Yeah. So,
you know when people crump dance and they kind of go sideways? So it's a Board Boys crump.
Yeah. Yeah. Sure. So Rob's going to throw out a game that we played at a previous point in the podcast, and we're going to talk about if we think it's higher or lower rank, or if it's more high or less lower. I don't know why I'm struggling with this. If it's higher or lower ranked than when we played it last time.
All right, so the game is Wingspan.
That game wasn't even on the top 100 when we played it, and it's like 30th overall now. So yeah, we bumped it.
We played Wingspan in March 2019.
For the record, that was not an official episode of the Board Boys podcast. It was official, but that was a bonus episode of the Board Boys podcast because Jamie Stegmeyer and Stonemeyer Games provided us with a review copy. And so we did a mini review episode. We did not feel comfortable doing a full review because it was at the time not anywhere close to the top 100, which is normally where we focus in on games. So that's a quick 30-minute episode if you're looking for something a little bit shorter to digest.
Yeah, so it actually was pretty close to the top 100 at the time. It was 206 with an 8.28 rating. And Wingspan is now an 8.1 rating. So it went down, but because of sweet, sweet, sweet BGG algorithms, because it's probably been rated like 50,000 more times since then, it is up to number 20. Wingspan is 20th.
That does not surprise me at all.
And it is the number one family game.
Filthy casuals.
That also does not surprise me at all.
So I'd like to just say that I rated it a 7.5. I love Wingspan. Actually, I was going to suggest playing it last night. I'll play Wingspan anytime.
You want to play it after this?
No.
You said anytime.
That I go to bed.
Josh and I will play.
After, in your basement after you go to bed.
So, but I just got to say this. And I don't want to get into a, like a 20-minute argument.
We're going to, because you and I are at totally opposite ends of the spectrum
but,
on this one.
But
is this one? I agree with you on, yeah, on Wingspan.
Here we go.
But
I'm ready for it. I'm so ready.
Due to my rating,
sure, Josh, you can look at me and like how
much
you look at
and how much everybody likes it. I think Wingspan is overrated, overhyped.
I 1,000% disagree with you. As we've talked about multiple times, I think Wingspan is 100% deserving of the praise that it gets. I think it totally deserved to win the awards that it did and the accolades that it did. I think it took a topic that nobody was interested in and made an incredible game. I think it did more for the board gaming, just like general awareness. I like there's been a lot of board games with the COVID-19 stuff that have made their way into like mainstream media, but I can't think of another game that had an article, a full editorial article in the New York Times about the game because the theme of the game was so unique and it was so appealing to people. I think that Wingspan, it, like, you hear a lot of people that complain about, like, not a lot of people, but there are people that complain about like the casual gamer and how they wish that they had a game that was a little bit more gamey that they could play with their casual friends. And I think this game is an answer to those prayers.
Check it. It's got combo wombo. It's got wobble. It's got unique.
It's got
the
unique.
Three of the four pillars of board.
It's beautiful. It's got the cool board that you can build out.
Yeah.
Like you can look down at your board and feel great about it. Mechanically, it may not have broken down walls, but I think that game does so much for gamers. And I think a lot of people are like, oh, the game's overhyped. What do you want? It's the number one family game. It's not Tricarion with all of the expansions or Twilight Imperium 4th edition. This is a game that, like, this game, the reason I think it's so deserving of the praise is without knowing anything about it, my mom saw it and was so compelled in just the way that it looked, which hats off to the artistry, but said, what's that game about? Let's check that game out. And that has never happened. Ever has that happened.
And think about this. Beating Catan and Ticket to Ride now, you won't have to look at, like millions of different, like, how are they going to make a billion Wingspans the way they made a billion Catans and Ticket to Rides and people gunking up their shelf with like a million different versions of the exact same game?
They will.
I don't think they will.
Because there's going to be a million expansions
Can I
speak now?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Go for it.
I was ready.
I don't disagree with anything you just said. I'm just saying the gameplay is nothing, in my opinion. It's a fine game. I rated a 7.5. That's lower than an 8.1. Mm-hmm. For me, that's overhyped. And, I mean, overrated, I guess. Technically, for me, that's an overrated game, right? But I also think it's just like, I wasn't like blown away. Like, this isn't like some magical mm-hmm. new thing that like did something new that nothing ever happened before. Like, this is just a card game engine builder, kind of a tableau builder with birds. So like originally when I saw it, I'm like, birds don't care.
That's what everybody, and that's why
and
it's
then,
so good. So
let me finish. And then I played it and I'm like, oh, that's really fun. And then I bought it. So, I mean, that was cool. And I could play with lots of people. So, I mean, I love the game, but that doesn't mean I don't think it's overrated/overhyped. Like it doesn't, I don't know. It won all these Board Game Geek awards, like for most innovative game. It's not the most innovative game.
But here's where I think
and it won like best card game and best board game. Like if you ask people, is Wingspan a card game or a board game? It just won all these awards because it's so so popular, right? But like Cam, is Wingspan a board game or a card game? Like if you could only win one of the categories,
board game.
I would say card game.
You would say it's a card game?
Yeah. Because
it's got like little eggs, and it's got player boards.
You have a board that, but the whole game is built around, like, based on the cards that you play.
Okay, I think you're in the minority of people that would call a card game.
Well,
here's a counterpoint, though, Rob.
It won the award in both categories, so it doesn't matter. But here, but real quick, I think the biggest thing that you and the reason that you and I will always, always get into a debate on this game is because when it comes to the word innovative, you and I have different definitions for how we are judging the game. I think it's safe to say that when you think of innovative, you are looking for that new, clever mechanism in a game that you've never seen done before that really makes the game like, oh my gosh, this is incredible. And I think that's important, but I'm also looking at everything else around the game, from the production, the promotion, for the general appeal to the community, and where, like you said, it's an engine builder, it's a tableau builder, it doesn't do anything fancy there. Sure, I'll give you that one, but everything else wrapped up, I could definitely see why the year that this game came out, it was the most innovative game in the year that it came out.
I mean, Stonemaier does all their games the same way. This one just seemed to hit like harder than anything else in the most,
because it's like a family game.
He's like an amazing marketing genius.
But like, Rob, I'm gonna strike one from the record because I know you have the answer for me. I can only think of one family game, like one family game that is incredibly unique, like in comparison for like how popular it is, and that's Quacks at Quedlinburg. But like, I don't think the important thing for like the huge game is to be particularly innovative. Like if I'm thinking about like, who do I see winning like the best album Grammy? Like if it's One Direction, I'm going to be like, eh. But if it's something I can stomach that I think is really pretty good, that a lot of people like, has mass appeal, then like, that's awesome. But I'm never going to think that my favorite band is going to be winning the Grammy for best album because they're like super innovative. I'm fine with that being a niche. I think that the Wingspan is a huge step up for the hobby from Settlers of Catan, and to a lesser degree, Ticket to Ride, which I think is a way better gateway game than Settlers of Catan.
Do you think that Wingspan is the 20th best board game?
Yes,
in the history of board games,
I would say it's better than the. I think it will continue to climb, and I think it deserves it.
I think that list is a meta, just like you know.
Oh, it is. I'm just asking you if you think that it is, like.
Do I think that Wingspan is the 20th most important board game right now? Yes. Do I think it will remain the 20th most important board game, or be the 20th best board game in 5 years? No. But I do believe very much that it deserves its spot at number 20 in 2019 and 2020, and time will tell if that remains.
I don't know if you guys are trying to like change my mind or what, but like, I don't disagree with anything any of you are saying.
I have told you that
I'm just saying it's overrated.
I have said before, and I will stand by,
because it's a fine game.
This is the hill that I will die on.
And I own it. And I own the expansion.
I know you do.
And I just bought like Meeple upgrade stuff for it.
And hats off to Jamie Stegmaier and Stonemaier Games, because we raised $700 for the iOS.
And
the
doesn't
yeah, I've got like little plastic birdhouses like, coming
and,
for
and,
it.
It's great.
And doesn't it freak you out that Josh and I are so in agreement about this?
It's kind of scary.
Anyway. Cam, I'm sorry, man. We're just out of time.
No, we are doing kazoos. No, we are doing kazoos.
We'll do it next episode.
No way. We are doing kazoos.
If you like what you heard,
I'm getting the kazoos right now. We're doing it.
We have new episodes every other Thursday on your favorite podcast platforms, wherever you're listening now. We are on. Thank you so much for checking us out. If this is your first time, we'd love for you to like us and subscribe and do all those things that content creators like you to do. We are on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter at either the Board Boys Pod or the Board Boys Podcast. We are also Guild number 3455 on Board Game Geek. But I think that's a wrap. This is season 7, episode 3. This is Josh Ladd boning out.
I hope you like board games.
You guys cannot do this to me.